Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our service of worship here in St. Columba's. It's good to see you, and especially good to see our young people back with us in church this morning, and visitors from away as well. You're very welcome, all the way from Hong Kong. Yep, good to have you with us, and we trust that together as we worship and praise our God, we will indeed know his peace and his presence and hear his voice speaking to us this morning. Special welcome to those joining us online or on our dial a sermon. We trust that you too will know God's blessing. And just a few announcements. On Tuesday evening between 6 and 7, we're having a walk-in Christmas present evening for our boys in the Boys Brigade. So boys, if you come and come into the hall, there'll be some presents there for you. And we'll keep the proper social distancing and all the rest of it. But that's Tuesday at between 6 and 7. Also on Tuesday evening at Martin's Church, the Tommy McNeil is having a book launch for his book, and we commend that event to you as well. Thursday will be our midweek meeting on Zoom, and there'll be more details about that on our Facebook page during the week. Next Sunday morning, we're having a family service, and it's great to see some of our young people back with us in church this morning, and we look forward to you all being here and sitting in your family bubbles next Sunday, which will be the Sunday before Christmas, and we look forward to celebrating together. Our thanks to the Guild for supplying presents for the junior Sunday school and creche, which they had a walk-in for that yesterday. And our day of giving, the box will be there until the end of the service this morning if anyone has donations for the day of giving. Remember too, donations for our food bank, you can leave those in the table in the hall. Otherwise, if you drop them off with Agnes at the rectory in Goat Hill Crescent, not later than Tuesday, she will see that they're passed on to the Salvation Army for our food bank. Over the years, normally in normal pre-COVID times, there's been opportunities for people to make donations through your mission fund, and we haven't had that this year. But we'll have a retiring collection next Sunday, purely for our mission fund. So we commend that to you for next Sunday's family service. Donnie is going to be leading our service this morning, so I'm going to hand over to you now, Donnie.
It's good to worship God. The psalmist exhorts us to make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Let's worship God and sing to his praise in Psalm 100.
Thank you.
come into God's presence in prayer. Let us pray. Our glorious Lord and God, we thank you that we are in your presence. We hear your word encouraging us to approach you with great joy and thanksgiving. We ask that as we experience your loving presence, that our hearts will indeed be filled with joy. Grant us eyes of faith, Father, that we might behold your Son, the Lord Jesus, who you have presented as the gift from heaven to us, your people. And what greater gift could we receive than knowing the Lord Jesus Christ, experiencing his great love for us, knowing that our sins have been cleansed and washed away through his precious blood shed on the cross. And we thank you that we, as your people, share in the resurrection power of Jesus as we live lives that are energized by the Holy Spirit poured out into our lives and hearts. We pray that we would share some of the joy that Mary, the mother of the Lord, experienced in her own heart when she knew that she was carrying the Son of God. We also pray that we would experience the joy of her cousin Elizabeth when she met with her younger cousin Mary, and the baby John the Baptist leapt in her womb with great joy. We also pray that we would be filled with the same joy that engulfed the hearts of the shepherds as they heard from the angel that a Savior, a Lord, and a Christ had been born in the city of David. We pray that as your people in St. Columba's congregation, that we would carry your joy and your presence. We pray that we will know the reality of our union with Christ through the Holy Spirit. And we pray that we would live in the joy that the Lord Jesus brings to our hearts. We pray at this time too for those who are suffering. Our hearts and our minds go to the people living in the Midwestern states of the USA who are recovering from the dreadful aftermath of the tornadoes that ripped through their lives yesterday. We pray that you will be with the bereaved, that you will comfort all who have lost loved ones and friends, We ask that you will provide for the homeless, for those who have been left without power or water. And we pray that you will give great strength to all who are involved with the rescue efforts, that you will bless them, Lord, and that you will grant them power to seek out and to find those who are still buried under rubble and who are missing. And Lord, we thank you for your goodness to us, and we thank you for the children who are present with us on this your day. We thank you for the Sunday school and for the Bible class. We give you praise for the teachers and all who give so generously of their time to see the children of this church grow in knowledge and grow in faith. And we pray that the children and teachers in the Sunday school would know and experience the power of your Holy Spirit, the power of your love, your joy, and your hope during this Advent season as we remember the Son of God who became one of us, who was born of the Virgin Mary, and who lived a perfect life on our behalf to carry our sin and to join us in fellowship with the triune God. And as we contemplate this great truth, we say the prayer that you taught your disciples to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. So it's so good to see the boys and girls back in the church with us. Now, I wonder if you can think of things that make you really happy, that fill you with joy. I wonder what comes to your mind first of all. Are there any boys and girls who would like to share about any things that make them happy or give them joy? Well, I wonder if some of the things that make us happy are our family, our loved ones, our friends. Or does school make you happy? Or does Sunday school make you happy? I can think of things that used to fill me with a lot of joy when I was a child. That involved going out to the cattle grounds on a Sunday afternoon and climbing up some of the trees and coming home muddy and with my clothes torn and not being very popular with my parents. But I also really like reading. I like playing football. And sometimes I can say that I even liked school. And other times I really liked Sunday school too. All of these things made me happy, and all of these things can bring us joy. But there's someone else, there's something else that can bring us even greater joy than anything else in this world. And that is knowing the Lord Jesus Christ. And at this time of year, we remember when he came into this world. And there's a famous story in Luke's gospel that at the time that Jesus was born, there were shepherds guarding their sheep in the hills above the city of Bethlehem, where Jesus' parents, Mary and Joseph, had gone to so Mary could give birth to her child. And the shepherds were looking after their sheep when an angel of God suddenly appeared to them. You can imagine the shock and the feeling of wonder that the shepherds must have had when they saw this angel. And the angel had this to say to the shepherds: "Behold, I bring you news of great joy. A Savior, a Lord, a Christ has been born for you in the town of Bethlehem. And this will be a sign that you have found this baby boy. You will find him in a manger, a feeding trough for cattle, and he will be wrapped in cloth. And when you find him, you will know that this is your Savior. So the shepherds are filled with awe and joy. They rush into the city of Bethlehem looking for this Savior that the angel has told them about. And eventually they find the inn where Mary and Joseph are staying. And the gospel says that they see the baby Jesus wrapped in cloth, lying in a cattle's feeding trough. Can you imagine their joy? They were filled with such great happiness that after seeing Jesus, they ran out into the streets of Bethlehem and they told as many people as they could find that they had seen the Messiah, the one who was promised to Israel, the one who would save the people of Israel and the world from their sins. See, when we ask the Lord Jesus to come into our lives, he will fill us with joy. He will make us truly happy when we ask him to come and to show us his love. So this Christmas, as we sing the carols, as we look forward to receiving gifts, remember that the greatest gift that God has ever given you and I is his Son. And his Son will fill us with joy. So let's sing the famous carol. It's always good to sing carols at this time of year. O come, all ye faithful, joyful, and triumphant.
Oh,
If you'd like to turn in your Bibles to your scripture reading, which is found in Luke's Gospel, chapter 1. Luke's Gospel, chapter 1, and we'll be commencing to read at verse 39. In those days, Mary arose and went with haste into the hill country to a town in Judah. She entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary, the baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit, and she exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And why is this granted to me, that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For behold, when the sound of your greeting came to my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her from the Lord." And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked on the humble estate of his servant. For behold, from now on all generations will call me blessed, for he who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name, and his mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the mighty from their thrones and exalted those of humble estate. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, as he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham, and to his offspring forever." And Mary remained with her about 3 months and returned to her home. We pray that God will add his blessing to this reading of his word for his name's sake. Amen. We're going to sing again another carol, number 393 in Mission Praise, Isaac Watts' great carol, "Joy to the world, the Lord has come. Let earth receive her king. Let every heart prepare him room, and heaven and nature sing." Let us praise God. this, the third Sunday in Advent, as we look forward to celebrating the incarnation of our Lord at Christmas time, we also look forward with anticipation and expectation for our Lord's return as he promised he would, as he left to go back to glory and left his disciples outside Jerusalem. This Advent season reminds us of God's love for each one of us, his love for all humanity, a love that is changeless, a love that is undeserved, a love that is eternal. It's a season which gives hope for today, hope for tomorrow, and hope for eternity. A season that gives a hope that the world cannot supply. A season that brings light into the darkness. A season that brings comfort to dispel the despair and the despondency of our generation. Surely that gives God's people a reason to celebrate, secure in the knowledge that we have a Savior to trust in, that we have a Lord who pleads our cause in heaven before his Father's throne, a Savior who is coming again as King. That first Advent, when Christ's birth was first announced by the angel Gabriel to Mary, it brought an outpouring of spontaneous joy that overflowed to her cousin Elizabeth and to all those who were involved around the nativity story, from the shepherds, the wise men, their families, and the wider community. A joy that has been flowed through the pages of history, down through every generation. A joy that impacts Christians even today. And surely we truly can sing, as we just have, Isaac Watts' great hymn, "Joy to the World, the Lord has come." And that joy should surely be increasing exponentially in the knowledge that our Lord and Savior is coming again soon. However, given these times in which we are living, given the challenges which we face day by day in 2021, never mind the wider concerns for our generation, both locally and globally, we need to ask ourselves just how evident is our joy in the Lord as we go about our normal business. Do others recognize the joy that is in our hearts? These times, it can be a challenge for us all. And I've no doubt that sometimes our joy is less evident than it should be. Mary was chosen by God in order to fulfill his plan to save humanity. She hadn't been mentioned before we come here to Luke's Gospel. She didn't have a glowing CV to make her an obvious choice as someone to select in a plan to change the world. To all intents and purposes, the society of her day, and no doubt our day as well, would have viewed her as a nobody. But God saw her as somebody. God chose her to give his Son, the Savior of the world, his human credentials, to give his Son his human DNA, his humanity, his identity with each and every one of us. When God's looking for someone to do his work or to do a specific task for him, he doesn't use our human criteria when he's selecting a person for that work. Paul reminded the Corinthians, God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. He chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to nothing things that are, so that no human being might boast in the presence of God. When you came into church this morning, how were you feeling? Were you feeling joyful? Christmas is almost here. Are you thinking about all that you've still to do and prepare for? Wondering what sort of a Christmas we're going to have as we wait to hear Nicola's latest pronouncement at the beginning of the week? Was your joy evident to the others in church as you came and took up your seat? Or did you come into church this morning with a low self-esteem, thinking God would never choose or select me to do anything? Well, friends, if that's the case, the good news is that the gospel is just this, tells us that you are the sort of a person, however you feel, that God chooses to change the world. Think about that. You're the sort of person that God chooses to change this world. Just as he chose Mary, he still chooses, still calls, still equips, and still resources, and still uses the most unlikely of people to carry out his plans and his purposes today. God knows you, he knows me, he knows each one of us intimately, better than we know ourselves. As the psalmist reminds us, he was the one who knit us together in our mother's womb. He knows the gifts and the talents that he has endowed you and me with. And he has given you those gifts and talents for a work that he has for you to do, a unique work that he has chosen you for. This morning he calls us again to follow him and serve him, no matter who we are, no matter how inadequate we may feel. Is that not something to be joyful over? Is that not something to cause us to rejoice? That the God of our Creator God, the God of all glory, gives the grace and the strength to each of us to do the work that he has prepared and is preparing us for. In the Old Testament, in the prophet of Zephaniah, God speaks through him and says, I take great delight in you. I will rejoice over you with singing. If God is rejoicing over you with singing this morning, surely that stirs your heart to rejoice, to praise, to thank him for his goodness, for his love, and for the fact that he has chosen you for a purpose to serve him. Surely it's something for us all to be joyful about. Something that all God's people together can raise their hearts and voices in praise day by day and use to encourage one another when the media and others are downplaying life in general. Last week, Donnie shared with us Gabriel's statements to Mary and the responses she gave to the news that she was to be the mother of the Messiah. I've no doubt that news had given her a whole range of emotions and feelings as she reflected on this amazing news, wondering how it would be possible for something like that to happen. Wondering and concerned and perhaps fearful of the impact it would have for her and for Joseph in that small town community of Nazareth. And yet Luke tells us she simply, humbly accepted the news that was given to her by Gabriel, responding, I am the Lord's servant. May it be to me as you have said. If anyone ever had reason to boast about their mission in life, if anyone ever had reason to crow about the work that God had called them to, then surely it was Mary. No human before, no human since, has ever had such an important role to fulfill. But Mary simply submitted to God's sovereignty, to his plan and purpose for her, and she did it quietly and humbly. Throughout the pages of the New Testament, she never seeks the limelight, but rather throughout the Gospels, she remains quietly behind the scenes. Her joy at the news that her child would be the Messiah overflowed into her song that we call the Magnificat, which we have just read here in Luke. It's the only time we see her expressing and rejoicing, certainly in a private environment within her cousin's home with someone that she could share with. But she accepted the news that her job that she was to do for her Lord was unique, and she accepted it humbly, and yet she rejoiced. It shows us that her one desire was that she would be a blessing to all nations. And the joy which overflows in this song here recorded in Luke wasn't for her own glory, but rather that the birth of the Messiah, the child that she was bearing, would herald a changed world for wearied and burdened people. The child she was bearing would bring hope and give not only her, but everyone, the whole of humanity, cause to rejoice and be joyful. Nowhere in Scripture do we find Mary talking about her unique son. Rather, it's her humble silence which speaks so much more eloquently. Only twice we read in Luke's Gospel, chapter 2, that Mary treasured all these things and pondered them in her heart. Firstly, after the shepherds visited and announced to them their account of the angels announcing that the Savior had been born. 12 years later, when she and Joseph had to return to Jerusalem to search for Jesus, and finding him in the temple, debating with the teachers, she again treasured all these things and pondered them quietly in her heart. These amazing events, these amazing pronouncements about the Son of God whom she was bearing. Her quiet dignity and humility are surely an echo of the same dignity and humility that her son displayed when he was on trial before Pontius Pilate, where Jesus maintained his silence, refusing to speak a word in his own defense against all the false accusations made against him. There was no one in Nazareth that she could share her good news with and talk to about what was happening. But it didn't stop that joy within her erupting. She needed to tell someone. She needed to share the good news, not only that she was having a baby, but her baby was to be the Savior of the world. And so we read that she left Nazareth and traveled to share the news with the one woman in Palestine who would understand, the only one who could have true empathy with her in the unique role in which she was filling, the one person that she could share her joy with, her older relative Elizabeth, who was celebrating her own amazing and miraculous good news and already 6 months pregnant. As Mary arrived in Zechariah and Elizabeth's home, that good news which she had accepted so quietly and humbly was affirmed and celebrated. And even Elizabeth's baby in her womb leaped for joy. A prenatal prophetic response by John, the one who was already preparing the way for Jesus. And Elizabeth and her baby, John, were filled with the Spirit, and together they witnessed to the Messiah's imminent arrival. cause for rejoicing, a cause for joy as never before. The long promised and the long awaited for Messiah of the world was about to arrive in a few months. Mary's quiet humility, her wisdom, her courage as the wonderful news was affirmed, enabled her to break forth and erupt spontaneously as she breaks into song. Her joy could not be contained any longer. Her joy has continuously flowed to every generation since. I wonder, have you ever experienced a joy that you couldn't contain? A joy that you just had to share with someone? I think I've told you the story before of a friend from Zimbabwe who was, when he was born as a child, he was the seventh child in a household of six girls. And when the father heard the good news from the midwife that he had a son at last, he rushed out into the village and charged through the village, shouting, "It's fabulous, it's fabulous." And fabulous became the name of my friend, and he's still fabulous today. Good news that this man had waited for seven pregnancies before he had the son that he was longing for. But he had to share it. It was a spontaneous outpouring of joy. When God speaks to us through his word, whether it's read, whether it's preached, when he calls us to a specific task, it's often wise for us to share that news quietly with someone close to us and someone dependable, with someone who understands, with someone who we know is traveling or has traveled a similar road, with someone who is mature in their Christian faith, someone who can recognize and affirm God's call and God's plan for our lives. And as we share together, we can rejoice at God's plan for each one. We can do so in a dignified and reverent manner. There was no exhibitionism in Mary's response to God's call. Just simple, humble obedience and joyful thanksgiving that manifested itself in poetry and in song. In the brief glimpses we have of Mary in the Gospels, we see something of the depth of her spirituality. Her joyful song, recorded by Luke, reveals to us a young life that was saturated in the Old Testament scriptures. The words of her song resonate with those of the psalmist in the Old Testament, with those of the prophets in the Old Testament. Her song reverberates with Hannah's prayer in 1 Samuel 2. Her song echoes many of the prophetic words spoken by Isaiah, by David, by Job, and by Moses. Mary's childhood had been spent learning the stories of her people Israel. The poetry of the Old Testament writings had been memorized by her long before she gets a mention in the Gospels. The unrecorded years of Mary's upbringing display a deep spiritual devotion and knowledge of God and his word. When that she is suddenly elevated to the world stage as the mother-to-be of the long-promised Messiah. And so her spontaneous outpouring of tangible and contagious joy demonstrates a private devotional life which had prepared her during her formative years for the unique role that God, her Heavenly Father, had created her for. Mary was the mother of our Lord. And it was at her knee that the child Jesus would have first heard the scriptures. It was in Mary's arms that the child Jesus learned how to pray as she prayed with him and for him. It was with Mary that he would have experienced something of the joy of the Lord as it overflowed in her gratitude and thanksgiving. Here Jesus would have witnessed what humble service to the Lord is as he saw his mother's obedience. Friends, as we catch a glimpse of Mary's commitment and devotional life, it surely challenges our own. How is your personal devotional life? Have you taken time to consider what its temperature is in recent days? In moments of extreme joy or indeed extreme pain, do you spontaneously turn to the Scriptures as an immediate response, as naturally as you breathe, in the way that Mary did? Mary's song reveals to us a woman who knew God as her Savior, a woman who knew God's faithfulness to her and to previous generations. She recognized God's bias to the hungry and the poor. She understood something of his justice for the oppressor. She knew God's word and she loved God's word. She lived her life by God's word. And her song, Hear the Magnificat, is theological, it's political, it's historical, and it even has economic overtones. Mary's spirituality was holistic. It touched all aspects of her life, from social justice to God's sovereignty and supremacy, from personal experience to God's faithfulness to her people and her ancestors. The last mention we have of Mary in the Bible, in Luke or in Acts 1 and 14, again written by Luke, reveals the depth of her enduring spirituality. Luke tells us that she was there with the other disciples, with Jesus' brothers, with the other women in the upper room after Jesus had ascended to heaven. Mary was at the heart and the center of that small group engaged in prayer in Jerusalem. And she disappears from the pages of the New Testament praying. That's how she handled her grief and her heartbreak. Just as with any sinner, her only hope of salvation was in prayer to the Savior, trusting in his atoning death for her on the cross. She trusted her pain to him. She trusted her confusion to him. She trusted everything to the God whom she knew from these early days when Christ's birth was announced, that all things are possible with our God. Take a few moments now and quietly reflect on your own mother and give God thanks for her. Let's thank God, too, that no matter who we are, no matter how inadequate we might feel, he is the one who still calls each one of us by name from our obscurity to follow him, to serve him in the way that he leads us, in the way that he guides us, in the unique work that he has for each of us to do. We must trust him. We need to obey him. And then we will truly know the joy of the Lord in our lives. As the old hymn says, trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. So friends, let's strive to deepen our spiritual lives day by day, reading and meditating on God's word, rebooting our devotional lives, memorizing God's word and embedding it in our very being by spending more time alone with Him in prayer, more time fellowshipping and praying with other believers in small groups in the wider congregation of God's people, and being active participants in this community of God's people of which we are a part here in St. Columbus. May we each experience more of the eternal joy that awaits us when we get to glory, that we can experience here and now as we gather for worship, a foretaste that will surely cause an eruption of spontaneous joy amongst all God's people, such that our community and the wider world will notice and will wonder and attract them to seek the Lord for themselves. May our joyful witness to our Savior bring hope, bring the love and the peace of our God, which this Advent season heralds, to our families and to our society this Christmas. May we all know and experience the joy of our Lord and know it as our strength day by day. May that joy overflow from us to impact those around us this Christmas season. This is God's word to us this Advent Sunday. So let's take the joy of the Lord with us from here into the week ahead and share it as God gives us opportunity. And as we share it, watch how your joy will increase and watch the impact it will have on those around you in these difficult days. Amen. We're going to draw our service to a close singing the words from Luke 1 here, from Mary's Song, written by Timothy Dudley Smith, 631 in Mission Praise. Tell out my soul the greatness of the Lord, unnumbered blessings give my spirit voice, tender to me the promise of his word, in God my Savior shall my heart rejoice, and make it a personal prayer as you sing it. Let us praise God. we go into the week in front of us, not knowing what it holds for any of us, may we all be able to echo the words of the prophet Habakkuk when he says, though the fig tree should not blossom, nor fruit be on the vines, the produce of the olive fail, and the fields yield no food, the flock be cut off from the fold, and there be no herd in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will take joy in the God of my salvation. God the Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like the deer's. He makes me tread in the high places. And now may grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be with us all this day and evermore. Amen.